from a small business perspective, when you say you only have 25% of capacity, you know, that creates a lot of challenges. One, at 25%, you still have to open up the store. You still have to bring back employees. You know, you still have to get your inventory ready. You've got to pay all the utilities. And I think more often than not, it's going to cost small businesses in particular more to open up than if they would have stayed closed. That's part one.
Joining me now is entrepreneur and investor Mark Cuban. He is also the owner of the Dallas Mavericks. And you may recognize him from one of my favorite shows, Shark Tank. Mark, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
And you guys are shooting new episodes, right?
Yeah, actually, we've got some new episodes in the can. So Friday nights, ABC, 8 Central, 8 Eastern, 7 Central. We've got like 4 or 5 new episodes still to go. And it's a great show to watch. And let me just say, one of the things I'm most proud of is not only does it say that the American dream is alive and well, but it's the number of, it's always one or two in terms of shows watched by families together. So it's just incredible. It's a great family show.
And I'm going to do my plug here. For those of you watching, please don't forget to like and subscribe to The Daily Caller. Now, Mark, I was kind of surprised when this all happened. You recently joined President Trump's advisory board for reopening the economy. And I know that you've been pretty critical of the president. I mean, you're very outspoken about things that you don't like. So what inspired you to sign on to this? And what exactly is your role? It's not like you're flying to the White House to meet up with everyone. We're doing things very different as we are doing a Zoom interview rather than one in person.
Well, first, I'm a patriot, right? Anything I can do to help my country, that's exactly what I'm going to do. I don't care who's in office. I mean, I have a tendency to not like politicians, period, end of story. But if I can do something to help the country, if I can bring the voice of my experience to help American citizens or help small businesses, whatever it may be, then I'm going to do it. And so they asked me to be on the committee, and I was on the sports council initially, and we had one call, and it was kind of ceremonial, where it was like, hey, we all want to get back to playing sports. Sports are good for the country. You know, once the science is in place, we'll start playing again. And we all kind of agreed with that. But to the president's credit, he had somebody reach out to me, and they assigned me a liaison who I've been talking to almost every day. And so I give them ideas about things that small businesses can do, ways they can improve their businesses, ways to interact with PPP, ways to open up more small businesses. And they haven't implemented them yet, but again, they've been very, very communicative, and we've been able to really address a lot of great issues.
So is it awkward at all because of your relationship with Trump?
No, I get along with a lot of people. I you know, in business, you don't necessarily have to agree with everybody to be able to do business with them. And you know, just through my history, there's been a lot of companies I've competed with and done, you know, charity work with, whatever it may be. And it's the same thing here. I mean, he's got the best interest of the country at heart. I have the best interest of the country at heart. And you know, even before he became president, we had an off and on relationship. One day he hated me. One day he liked me. One day he tweeted positive things. The next day he tweeted negative things. That's just the way he is. And I'm fine with that. As long as we have the mutual goal of helping the country, I'm down with it. I'm good.
And you're in Texas, and Texas is one of the first states that's really going forward with reopening its economy. Right now, retailers, restaurants, movie theaters, malls are reopening as of Friday, but they're only going to allow 25% occupancy. Do you support this?
Half and half. So half of the opening was that any company can do pickup and delivery, which is one of the things that I recommended to the council because it's worked so well for us, right? Restaurants have been doing it since the pandemic hit, and that's why a lot of us have been, you know, getting food. And, you know, with the Mavs, we've been buying food for first responders using pickup and delivery. So it's worked out really, really well. And so why not extend it to other companies, you know? And those same companies, in a lot of cases, are already selling online, doing delivery through UPS, et cetera, FedEx, whatever it may be. And obviously we're using Amazon. So it made sense to me to extend it. But when you use the word open, it suggests everything is back to normal and we're open for business. And in reality, that's just not the case. When from a small business perspective, when you say you only have 25% of capacity, you know, that creates a lot of challenges. One, at 25%, you still have to open up the store. You still have to bring back employees. You know, you still have to get your inventory ready. You've got to pay all the utilities. And I think more often than not, it's going to cost small businesses in particular more to open up than if they would have stayed closed. That's part one. Part two is the employees, right? So the way it is right now, you know, whether you like it or don't like it, with the unemployment insurance structure the way it is, a lot of employees are making more money on unemployment than they would if they would go back to work. But if that store opens up, then the employee has to go back to work and they can no longer collect the unemployment. So now you've got this tension between the employee and the employer. And that's not a good thing when both sides are worried about safety. So that leads us into safety, right? There really haven't been any guidelines that I've seen that tell a small business, each different type of small business, a restaurant, a clothing store, a nail salon, all the safety things you need to do. The best we've been able to say is social distancing and wash your hands and sterilize as much as you can. But there's so many unanswered questions. You know, the easiest example is you want to go into a clothing store, try something on, you decide you don't like it. You just put it back on the shelf. Does the clothing store have to sterilize it? So that creates a set of issues that haven't been addressed yet. And then finally, again, going back to the employees, when, you know, in every major city where there are employees that have to take public transportation, now that you're opening back up and a lot of businesses are just quickly opening back up, you've got all of a sudden this big rush of people now taking public transportation again. Maybe, you know, it's a subway, maybe it's a train, maybe it's a bus, whatever it may be. And you're just crowding people in there because all those schedules have been reduced. That increases their risk of getting sick. And if they get sick, you get sick, your customers get sick, and your business is done. And so it's not that I'm against opening up. I'm all for opening up. I want to see the economy get as close to normal as we ever possibly can get. But we got to take the right steps. We can't rush it just to say we're open. And so from my perspective, it's been more show than go. I mean, they really didn't think all the issues out completely.
There's a lot to unpack in everything that you just said. So let me pick your brain on a couple of things. You said It might cost businesses more to be operating only at 25% occupancy,
right?
But businesses aren't forced to actually open, correct? Right. So they can make those decisions on their own. And I think that's part of the argument is that people hate that the government stepped in and told them what to do. People fear big government, of course, but there's a balance here. We want to keep people safe. And I've heard you say this, and we know this, that the coronavirus is very scary. There's a lot of things that we don't know about it. We know that it's deadly. We know how easily it spreads. And then every day we learn something new, like we needed masks. Now we need to be 13 feet apart. So no one wants to get sick, right?
Right.
And
that's the catch 22, right? You're exactly right. We don't know all those details. And so if the business person, you know, the CEO, the entrepreneur decides that they want to open up, but they're not quite sure of all the science, but they feel like they have to take that chance because their business is so bad, or they're losing money, or they didn't get PPP money. And it's like, if I don't at least try, then I might fail. Then those are less able to invest what's required to keep their employees and customers safe. So you have a lot of people taking chances, you know, and typically that's okay. You know, that's the nature of being an entrepreneur. That's the nature of a startup or any business. There's risk involved. But typically, you don't have health issues involved as well for all the reasons you mentioned. And so that's the challenge. When you have a business owner who just wants to get going and wants to make that decision, but they're not, you know, financially or preparedness-wise ready to protect their customers and employees, how do you, you know, how do we as citizens know which one they are? Are they prepared or not prepared? You know, and so there's all these risks. And, you know, part of the response is, well, it's your choice. Do you want to go into the store or not? But unfortunately, you don't know until you're already sick whether or not you made a good choice or a bad choice.
And then you touched on something that I think has been really lost in this conversation is you're right. Some people are making more money off of unemployment than they would be working. So why work when you don't have to? But obviously, that's unsustainable.
Yeah, that's created a lot of problems too. I mean, I've talked to companies. See, what I'm finding out is that as this has gone on, you know, 6-7 weeks now, particularly in the restaurant industry where they've been able to be open, they've made adjustments, and there are restaurant owners and franchisee fast food owners that I've talked to that have cut their costs enough to be able to support the level of business that they're at with pickup and delivery to the point now where they're making more money now than they did before. Now, in big cities, that's a little bit easier than it is in smaller cities, but at the same time, it's happening and they're adjusting. And so to your point of letting business be business and letting the free market take over, you know, it's working with pickup and delivery. And, you know, part of the goal of even the smallest government is to protect our citizens and keep them out of harm's way. So it's a difficult balance, but I think we have, you know, like you said, this is such an unknown. Right now we have to err on the side of caution. And so that's why I've been I haven't been for the 25% side, but I'm all for the pickup and delivery side.
Yeah, so you're a big proponent of pickup and delivery, and I've heard you say that before. Have you talked to some of the restaurants that are doing this? Do you know what the profit margin is on that? Like, I know I've been picking up a lot of food. So
yeah, I mean, typically profit margins on restaurants are very low, right? But that's because you've got to be there in case you have a full house, right? And with pickup and delivery, you still have to have food there. You still have to do preparation, but it requires a skeleton staff. And so actually, you know, your margins can be higher if you have a skeleton staff and you're doing everything online. And, you know, the bigger challenge is with the delivery services, you know, Uber Eats or whoever you use or you're connected with, but even they have reduced their commissions. And so now it's becoming even more effective for pickup and delivery.
And then we touched on this as just one of the biggest challenges as we begin to reopen as a country is the legal challenges that businesses are going to face, the challenges of keeping their employees safe and their customers safe. And there's discussions about when people go back to work, are they going to have to sign waivers that they're not going to sue their employers? As a customer, is this like, you know, you're making your own decision. So if you get sick, it's your fault. How does that work?
That's to be determined. I mean, it really is going to come down to what we know about the science, you know, so we'll take our lead from the doctors and the scientists and go from there. I mean, I honestly don't have an answer for you right now, but I know it's a risk as a business owner. You know, I see it. I know I'm going to get sued and it's unfortunate, but you know, that's the country we live in. And I, you know, on the flip side, I also know I have to take care of my employees because if I don't, then, you know, my business isn't going to do very well and my brand is going to go into the toilet, right? So trying to find that balance is not easy right now.
Yeah, because we see every day new legal cases related to coronavirus are popping up. And a lot of them, you wonder if they really have a good case there.
Yeah, I mean, lawyers are going to be lawyers. Ambulance chasers are called ambulance chasers for a reason, you know, and it's just the reality. I'm sure we'll find ways to deal with it. You know, that's what entrepreneurs, that's what CEOs do. But it's unfortunate that we don't have better answers.
How would you rate the Trump administration's handling of coronavirus?
Oh my goodness. I'd say you'd have to break it down into segments. I think, you know, nobody has perfect information. All the information is imperfect. So I'd give him an A in terms of effort in trying to shut the country down and, communicate with us and bring the doctors to the forefront. Dr. Birx, Dr. Fauci, he's brought some real experts forward, that people that we can trust. I'd give him an E or an F, if you will, old school grading. I'd give him an F in terms of when he really started the push on creating a vaccine. And so, you know, I'm not even talking about the testing and the problems that CDC had. At minute one, whenever they found out that there was a greater than zero chance that this could be an epidemic or pandemic, even though there was all that uncertainty, I would have liked to have seen him say, you know what, let's make a significant investment in a vaccine. Let's get all the leading proponents and all the leading pharma companies so we get this started. Maybe it'll turn into nothing, but at least we're ahead of it. We're doing that now, but if we would have started this in November or December in January, rather than waiting till November to January, whenever hopefully we'll have a vaccine, we would have had it sooner. We would have been out of this sooner. Now, again, I'm not trying to throw him under the bus because that's a very hard decision to make. But that's what I would have seen. That's what I would have liked to see happen differently.
Yeah, I mean, there was just a lot that we didn't know. And we really weren't having these conversations until like February. And I remember when President Trump had banned travel from China, people were calling him a racist.
Yeah, and you know what? Yeah, I mean, he did the right thing. And that's great that he did it, right? And it helped us and it saved a lot of lives. But at the same time, you know, there's been discussions of pandemics for years now. And the minute we found out, whenever they found out, right, whether it's December or January, and we knew out of Wuhan that there was risk and it could spread here, somebody just should have said, you know what, just to play it safe, let's start investing in vaccines now, because if it's not this pandemic, there'll be another pandemic, and let's get that ball rolling. And that would have just bought us some time on the back end. And again, I'm not trying to throw them under the bus. I just would. You asked me to grade them. Half of them, I give them an A. That part of it, you know, I think it's an F.
Yeah, and there's a lot of question about China's role. Some are wondering, and even lawmakers, one lawmaker had proposed a bill that Americans should be able to sue China. We don't know exactly where the virus came from or how, but we do know that China had more information in advance. They weren't transparent with our country. And had they been transparent, that could have saved a lot of lives.
Yeah, there's no question. Look, you know, my response to that is I just want to kick their ass. And the way you kick their ass is by investing in robotics and bringing manufacturing back here. My concern, though, is that we're in trying to bring manufacturing back to the United States. We're trying to do it in the form of manufacturing 1.0, you know, put people on an assembly line and, you know, make things like we used to make them. That's not going to work anymore. If we really want to kick their ass, we have to invest in AI and robotics. And right now, particularly in robotics, we're behind Japan, Germany, and China. And so that's something we need to do as a country because, you know, I'm a big believer in American exceptionalism. And I know if we put our minds to it, you know, if we buy a billion products overseas, you know, we can bring back manufacturing of 500 million of those and create, you know, an untold number of jobs. Maybe they're not the old school manufacturing jobs, but that whole robotics infrastructure and ecosystem, and same with AI, will create millions of jobs that are better paying jobs that don't require a high skill set. But we haven't had that focus yet. But to me, that's the way we're going to really take it to China, by doing what America does. You know, when it comes to technology, when it comes to inventions, when it comes to forward thinking, that's why they have to copy us all the time, because we're the best in the world at it. And it's time for us to play to our strengths and invest in AI and robotics and just kick their ass. There's no other way to put it.
Yeah, and I like your thoughts on this, and this is something that you brought up during your virtual town hall with Charles Payne on Fox Business. You were talking about like made in America. You're very for that, and you said even on Shark Tank, you recommend to some of the people that you're working with to make it in America. And this coronavirus pandemic has really shown us how important it is to not be so reliant on other countries, specifically.
Yeah. Yeah, you're exactly right. I mean, whether it's medicines that are being made overseas that are counterfeited, or just now they're limiting the export of medicines from India and China, things that we need, whether they're products, these are things that we have the ability to lead in. You know, we always talk about the fact that we let manufacturing go, and that's true. But what we don't talk about is we use those same resources to invest in technology. You know, creating things like the internet, creating things like the mobile industry, the cloud industry, you know, Amazon type, you know, online purchasing. Those are things where we took old school money and put it into new school environment. We have to up the ante there. We have to do more of that. That's how we bring that home. That's how, you know, from the perspective of protecting ourselves, from the perspective of protecting our economy, from the perspective of never being in this position again, where we're dependent on another country, doesn't matter which one, but dependent on any other country for PPE, for our frontline healthcare workers, we need to bring it home. And the biggest mistake we could make would be trying to think that manufacturing is the way it used to be from the 20th century. It's not. That's not what's happening. And for us to dominate, and I know we can, we have to invest in it. And that should be our infrastructure investment.
Yeah, all good points there. Now, there are some who are questioning whether or not the lockdown in America was necessary, and they look to Sweden and how Sweden handled coronavirus or is handling coronavirus. What are your thoughts on that? Do you think that America went in the right direction when it came to handling coronavirus? I know that you gave the president his grade on handling it, but
I don't know. You can't prove a negative, right? Who knows what would have happened? I don't know. You know, it's a difficult decision to make. You know, like I said, I gave the president an A because he did the best he could with the information available. And based off of what we all had available to us, I think we made the right choice. But I don't know. I can't give you any guidance, or I don't know anything that anybody else doesn't know.
Now, I heard that you're keeping the door open when it comes to possibly running for president. Mm-hmm. What's stopping you from jumping in the race now?
Well, you know, my family, first of all, they're saying, no, don't do it. Otherwise, I already would have done it. And, you know, I'm keeping the door open because that's what entrepreneurs do. This is such a crazy time. You know, 6 months ago, if you would have said the entire economy was shut down on March 11th, effectively, and 6 weeks later, 30 plus million people would be out of jobs, everybody would say you're crazy. There's zero chance of that happening. And who knows what happens, you know, between now and November 3rd, any number of things. Plus, you know, when you really think about it, when you look at the candidates that we've selected from both parties out of the primaries, none of them were really geared towards fixing the pandemic. We didn't go into the primaries and say, you know what, we're going to have a pandemic, and these are the best candidates to deal with those issues. We're stuck on both sides. And so that's, you know, and we've been talking a lot about technology, and I think technology is going to be a big piece of us getting to the other side, growing the economy on the other side. And none of the candidates, none of the politicians that we have in place really are technologically literate. So you just never know what's going to change. And I just want to keep that door open. The likelihood is very slim, and, you know, slim to none, but crazier things have happened. And so that's why the door is open.
What are your thoughts on the presumptive Democratic nominee, Joe Biden?
I like Joe. I mean, he has his pluses and minuses, just like the president does. You know, he's got a different management style. I'm not a fan of the president's always blaming other people and always blaming the media and never taking responsibility. You know, I'm a fan of the president's ability to stand up to people and ability to, you know, to set an agenda and kind of stick with it like he's done with the judicial appointees. I think Joe is capable of doing all those same things as well. You know, each of them has their pluses and minuses. You know, I don't know who I'll vote for yet.
I'm sure you've been following the news, and Joe Biden's been accused of sexual assault from one of his Senate staffers from back in the 90s. And it's been like in the news cycle for like 6 weeks, but mostly ignored by most of the major networks. Today, he finally addressed it on MSNBC's Morning Joe. How badly do you think this is going to affect his campaign? As you may remember, what happened to Justice Brett Kavanaugh during the confirmation hearings, and Biden at one point said he believed all women no matter what. Now, of course, that only applies if they're not accusing him.
Right. Well, you know, I don't know. I don't have any information, again, that other people don't have. It's not really my place to jump in and try to judge. Typically, the facts tend to come out at some point. And when the facts come out, you know, that's when we can place a judgment. You know, I'm just, you know, the way I look at this right now is that we have so much to deal with the pandemic and trying to open up the economy and what we're going to look like. What is business going to be like on the other side? That's really where my core competencies are. I'm not into, you know, really placing blame or judging other people or, you know, trying to evaluate performance. What I really am focused on is how do we change the game? You know, what are we going to be, what's this country going to be like when we get to the other side? What kind of businesses are we going to have to invest in? How do we get more people employed? We've got 50 million people effectively unemployed or underemployed. We've got people who can't even get their applications for unemployment insurance into the system. We've got people begging for loans from PPP and they can't get it. And we don't know if there's going to be more money behind it. We don't even know if that money will solve anything. Those are the places I'd like to put my time and my energy, because that's where my experience is. And that's where I think I can really help. And again, we're not really hearing anything from the Republicans or Democrats about any of that. We're thinking, okay, let's give them money. The president thinks we're going to be back to normal by July. There's no chance. You know, I don't even know what Biden thinks in terms of where we'll be and how they get there. And so somebody's got to be out there really pushing the envelope in terms of what we're going to do with business. And that's my strength. And that's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah. And on the Biden thing, you know, I'm for due process and I'm listening to both sides there. And that's, I'm going to be consistent on that because that's what I've always said. And you touched on something, small businesses. Some small business owners that I've talked to haven't received the help that the government has promised them. They never received, were able to get the loans. They never received the money. Some of them filed for unemployment, couldn't get money that way either. So they're really stuck between a rock and a hard place.
Yeah. Yeah, there's no question. Small businesses are really up against it right now. You know, the PPP was called the Payroll Protection Program for a reason, because we wanted to get money in the hands of small businesses as quickly as possible so they could retain their employees. Unfortunately, it dragged on too long. And then when it got approved, because it went through banks, the banks did their best to process the loans as quickly as they could, but they're still banks. You know, they went through the old school approach for credit checks and evaluation of the application. That slowed things down. And then again, being who they are, they dealt with their existing customers first because that's who they knew. So that's where a lot of the money went. Smaller businesses, you know, unless they went through community banks, really didn't have a chance to get access to the money. Then we get to the second tranche and a lot of the same things are happening, but they actually changed the rules a little bit to slow down the big banks so that if anybody's watching is a small business or you're an independent contractor, you're better off going to a small community bank because they have fewer applications to deal with. So they can walk your loan application right through the whole process and hopefully get your money from the PPP program. That's part one. Part two, they threw independent contractors under the bus. They made it so difficult for anybody who's a 1099 type employee, contractor type employee, to get funding. And it's crazy the way it all worked out. In order to get that funding as an indie contractor, you have to have your tax return from 2018, and you have to show your tax return from 2019. Well, that may not seem like a big deal, but remember, the filing date for filing your taxes was pushed back from April 15th to, what is, July 15th? So a lot of independent contractors have not put together their taxes yet, so when they went to apply, they weren't able to apply. And those are the same people who can't apply for unemployment insurance. And nobody in the federal government or state government is doing a damn thing to try to help them. That is a problem. And so what I've been trying to push anybody who I've talked to or any shows like this, if you're an independent contractor, do your 2019 taxes. You don't have to file it yet, but take it to a small community bank. They can help you walk through. And for everybody, independent contractor or small business that is eligible for the PPP, it's okay to apply at more than one bank. Now, if you get approved by more than one, you can't take it from both. You can only take one, but apply to as many small banks as you can because they can walk you through the process. That increases your opportunity. And look, we could talk for days about the fact that, you know, 75% for payroll may not be enough. Leaving 25% for other expenses may not be enough to open up your business. 8 weeks is maybe crazy because if you can't even open up your business and you have to pay your employees and bring them back by June 30th, how can you do that if you're not even open or only open up 25%? There's so many things, again, that haven't been thought through. And all these things are things I've said to the council and my liaison at the council, trying to get them to step forward. But they're running as fast as they can. And I understand why they can't get to everything or take all my suggestions. But, and by the way, I give them an A for communications or an A plus. They've done a great job. But for small businesses, they're kind of left in the lurch. And for independent contractors, they just got thrown under the bus.
Yeah, there's a lot to think about and a lot to sort out. Now, if we have a little bit of time, I wanted to do a little Q&A from some of my followers that have big questions for you. This one comes from Alan Mendelsberg. He asks, what do you think the NBA should do with the rest of the season?
We should play. The minute it's safe and the science says our players and important employees that will be part of putting on the game, we should play, not with fans, but for TV. Because we need our sports. We need something to cheer for. We need to root for the Mavs to beat the Suns or root for the Mavs to beat the Wizards, you know, and just get excited about something. And we just don't have that right now. And so as soon as it's safe, I'm sure the NBA is going to do all we can to get back on the court.
And this next one comes from Shannon Bruce. She says, how do you see the workplace changing after COVID-19? More remote workers? ? Thoughts about gig economy?
Definitely more remote workers, no question about it. I think particularly with big businesses and the cost of real estate, you're going to see them stop opening up small satellite offices. You're going to see them really try to make their buildings healthy, you know, changing the HVAC, you know, the air conditioning, and making it so when people go to work, they're not terrified to go into a conference room with 10 other people. And to do that, you're really going to have to reduce the number of bodies that are in your buildings. And so you're going to see a lot more work at home. And I don't know about your experience, but with the companies I've worked with, I mean, people are just as productive and getting just as much done in 4 or 5 or 6 hours as they did in 8 hours at the office without the commute back and forth, without having to take all the time. Plus, they can stay close to their families. There's so many other benefits and mental health benefits, if you will, from working at home for so many jobs. I think there'll be a lot of companies that really push to keep people working from home. And I think that's a good thing. In terms of the gig economy, well, obviously if people aren't going to work, you know, they're not going to take Lyfts and Ubers as much. And so it's going to be a challenge. But I think on the flip side of that, there'll be a lot more deliveries and a lot more online business and people ordering things for home. Just the things you need, like you're finding out, right? The things you need to work from home, the things I need to work from home, you know, you're going to be ordering a lot more online. So from a gig economy perspective, you might not see as many things driving opportunities with Lyft and Uber, but you will see more driving opportunities with delivery.
This one's from Jenna Baker. She says, what's one thing you wish you would have known when you started out as an entrepreneur?
That's a great question. You know what? I didn't respect sales as much as I probably needed to. You know, I learned somewhat the hard way that every sales cures all, and that every business needs sales to survive. And there were times when I thought, you know what, the sales will take care of themselves. And that's just not the case. If you're the CEO of a company, if you're the founder, you're an entrepreneur, you have to be able to sell your product. If you can't sell your product, how can you expect anybody else to sell it?
This one's from ZenMonk21 on Twitter. He didn't have a real name, but he says, Mark, do you think small athlete training centers that do personal training and small group training, not over five people, should be allowed to open? Our day-to-day cleaning is more extensive than some hospitals. So it sounds like he owns a small gym.
Right, obviously, yeah. It really depends on what kind of training. Like if you're training for football players and offensive linemen and defensive linemen and there's a lot of contact, you know, it may be too early. But as long as there's protocols in place, look, if you're going out to a park and you're working guys or women out and you're having them run and you can enforce social distancing, I have no problem with that. And I'll say this, you know, things that you would have done inside that you now can do outside, I'm all for it as long as there's social distancing. Because inside, if somebody happens to be sick, there's so many surfaces that can capture the virus, right, and retain it. Even when you try to clean it, as much as we try to be, you know, 100% effective in cleaning, we're always going to miss things. Whereas outside, it just falls to the ground. The grass and the dirt or whatever is not going to be a great environment for it to sustain it, the virus to sustain itself. So, you know, I've already talked to like restaurants and saying, you know, put out picnic benches and sell out in parks and, you know, just so many different ways. So to answer your question, N1, whatever, yeah, I'm not opposed to it if you do it outside. Inside, it's going to be much more difficult. I know you do a lot of cleaning and scrubbing because you're worried about MERS and other things. But until we have those protocols, until we know more, I prefer outside workouts.
And I'll just take one last question because I know you're kind of busy. This one's from Josh Melberg. He says, if you were president, what would you do differently in handling COVID-19?
I would have started the vaccine a lot earlier. I would have, you know, found the best sources for testing and bought up all of them as much as I could. Anything that we could have licensed, I would have licensed multiple patents so that we could manufacture here. I would have done, I would have taken over whatever manufacturing we needed to from pharma companies to produce those here so that we can have millions of them. I would create federal jobs. Now that we have so much unemployment, I would create jobs for tracking and testing. You know, 30 million people plus unemployed, we can give jobs to 2 million of them and pay a decent wage and have them and train them, you know, in HIPAA and being healthcare workers to go out there and do the tracking and tracing. And I can go down a long list of things that I would have done.
Well, Mark, I never stop asking questions or talking, so I'll leave it here. Thank you so much for your insight, and thank you for what you're doing and trying to help us safely reopen the country. We really appreciate it, and we're looking forward to the NBA season.
You and me both. Thanks so much, Stephanie. Great job. I really appreciate the questions.
Thanks a lot.